Welcome to From the Democratic Left. It's our end of the year show. We do this traditionally, actually not that often, but traditionally. And we have, I think, is going to be a big scoop. But I know the good news will travel so rapidly among the right wing. That is, and here's the big scoop, Big Jim Blykamp, a frequent guest on this show, is leaving town.
Aww.
And... yes, he's leaving town, and he's promised to reveal on this show where exactly he is tattooed with the Mark of the Beast. Jim. So you're out of here. This is it.
This is it. After 5.5 years, Bob, it appears that my legacy in Columbus is going to boil down to this program. I'm leaving. No,
no, this isn't the Larry Levine show, Jim. Just sit down there.
No, it's very nice to be here. It is.
Very nice. You've been here before. You've been in the basement?
Yes, I have.
Now, we have... yeah. These are Christmas decorations. Now, I want to get to some of the myths or perhaps facts about you.
By the way, would this be a Supreme Court allowed kind of Christmas display with various symbols?
Well, since there's no religious symbols and it has a secular intent, Jim, I think a liberal like yourself could live with this.
I think it would pass constitutional muster. Especially on a blasphemous program
like this
one.
Now, is it true that you've spent most of your life dissing the baby Jesus?
No, not at all. Not at all. By the way, that's... I'm really kind of glad you brought that up, because really, Bob, we should not make assumptions, and every year at this time we should run through that. The fact... that many of us, I would dare say, when it comes right down to it, I think once people understand the issue, most of us in this country respect and understand the need for a separation of church and state. That includes some very religious people. To believe in, to respect the tradition of a separation of church and state is not in any way to show disrespect for religion, or in your terminology, to diss the baby Jesus.
But is it not true that every single year you favored kicking the nativity scene off the courthouse lawn in Delaware?
I think we're better off without religious symbols on public taxpayer-funded property. I say that as a religious person. And a lot of people won't believe it, but I am.
And on the other hand, you have no problem whatsoever with State Auto putting up the world's largest nativity scene on its private property.
Not at all. In fact, I haven't seen it, but the pictures I saw in the paper I thought were very interesting.
And you would defend their right to do that as a private concern, would you not?
With my life.
Okay. Other things, a very successful tenure with the Birch campaign.
Thank you, Bob. Well, I just want to say, I really enjoyed that. For anybody who doesn't know, and I think probably 90% of them don't know, that I was the communications director of the Rob Birch campaign for governor, and I'm very proud of having done that. We were at a tremendous disadvantage in a number of respects, notably a financial disadvantage. We did not have nearly the money. I think we had something like 1/100th, if that, of the money that the Voinovich campaign had. And of course, it's hardly the world's best kept secret that this was a heavily Republican year. That's usually the case for the party that occupies the White House during a midterm election. It was even more so the case this year. So we were running uphill in almost every respect you can imagine. But I think for those who bothered to pay attention, and by the way, I would credit the major print media of the state with doing a pretty good job of covering the issues. For anybody who wanted to follow the campaign, there was ample evidence that Rob Birch, I think, was interested in giving government back to the people of Ohio who have not had it, as far as I'm concerned, during the Voinovich administration.
Well, let me actually, in all fairness, I think you did a great job as the media director, which would influence the print media. I think you got your message out there, but the reality is, who reads today? Isn't elections pretty much decided by these 30-second propaganda commercials? Either your opponent is virtually a criminal and you're virtually a saint.
It's a real problem. It's a real problem, and one of my, I think there's been so much media attention. I'm talking about free media attention, the attention of commentators this year to the nature of these spots. It's really interesting. This I think was the year when it once and for all became the thing to do to basically cover the campaign by way of covering the spots. There may have been more print and free media attention to the spots with good reason than was given to, you know, a lot of campaign events around the state.
So you were in talk radio, and many people have said that the Limbaugh and the Limnoids or whatever they are has had a tremendous impact on changing the nature of debate in this country. We don't see people, I remember when you first came to town, there was an article, right? There's a liberal with a microphone.
Mm-hmm.
You don't see too many liberals with a microphone anymore, do you?
No, but I do think, within the next few years, especially, perish the thought if the Republicans retake the White House in 96, you will probably hear more liberal points of view on the air.
So, what are you going to do in your new real life? As you're heading to Hartford, Connecticut.
I'm heading to Hartford, Connecticut to program and consult, at least for a time, news and talk radio station. Sound familiar?
Jim,
have I read this book before?
Now, Jim, would the first thing you do is bring in all the homo-loving, baby-killer, feminazi types and completely destroy the family values at this station?
Well, that's half right. We do bring those in, but we also square them off against your basic shaved-head right-wingers, and we watch them go at it, and it's fun.
So the old marketplace of ideas.
That's right.
Yeah.
Both sides.
When we talk about liberalism, I've been a big, not a fan, but a tremendous critic of WTVN because I believe their political spectrum has shifted so far to the right since you left. But how much do you think the effects of, say, their owner being, you know, the Lindner family would have on the media in general?
You mean on that radio station that he owns?
Yes.
I think there's definitely an impact. On the other hand, I will say in fairness that I was hired there, and I spent a year and a half there while he was owning it. My sense is that he that it's really more of a financial investment for him. I'd be the first to say if I thought that he was getting involved in the management of programming at this or at any of the other radio or TV stations he owns. Now, I'm not saying that day won't ever come, and I'm not saying that there couldn't come a time when he would get involved, especially if it were to protect his interests in one way or another. But I don't have any I don't have any particular evidence of that. I'll tell you what I really think is the most dangerous aspect of that. I'm glad you brought that up. The various people, especially in the news departments of his radio stations, might be a little naturally fearful before they'd run a story.
So it'd really be self-censorship in part. For example, do you think that show would go into what was, I think, the centerpiece of your campaign? And I think the most damning evidence against Governor Voinovich is what I consider the pay-to-play scheme, mm-hmm. of which the Lindner family is probably the largest recipient of welfare, money from the state.
Yeah, you have to explain a little bit exactly what you mean by that. It's been well documented in the Birch campaign. We documented beyond the shadow of any doubt that a number of the major Voinovich campaign contributors were effectively getting rewarded with various state loans, grants, tax breaks, largely through the Department of Development, which seems to serve as the reward station for campaign contributors. What's really interesting is if you look at the timing of some of these deals, and the fact of the matter is that the Lindner family has given Voinovich over $100,000 since 1990. And 73,000 of that figure came between January and October of 93. And guess what happened, Bob, on, I believe it was October 28, 1993, at the end of this gush of campaign contributions?
Nothing.
And you're wrong.
Okay,
$8.6 million. Package of loans, grants, and
He was doing a lot better than Hillary was with the cattle there, I think.
As Rob Birch said, not a bad return on the dollar. And as Rob Birch also said, I think pretty correctly, if anybody's going to be loaning money back and forth, maybe it ought to be Lindner loaning money to the state rather than vice versa.
And just recently, I know you wrote a final article in the Free Press, as you were leaving town, you pointed out the 0% interest loan that the Lindner family got from the state of Ohio.
Right after the election, yeah.
And you've got a lot of these 0% interest loans. Your Visa and MasterCard.
Oh, yeah. Every day. Well, you've given me two or three just on your
own. Well, yeah, the $5-6 at a time.
Feeding at that state trough over there.
You owe me for the popcorn. That was a 0% interest thing. And I owe you for the pig shampoo.
You know, I started to say this. Yeah, Bob bought some pig shampoo today for his pet, what is that, Vietnamese pot-bellied pig.
Yeah, I'm in favor of pork. I just like clean pork, Jim.
But you touched on something that I was starting to get onto about 15 minutes ago. It's all this talk about term limits, although it's interesting now that the Republicans have taken over. Some of their leaders, even in the House of Representatives, are having second thoughts now.
That'd be impossible, Jim. That would make them shallow opportunists.
Dick Armey, the new House Republican leader, has been backpedaling on term limits. But if that's the case, he's right the second time, because we just had, I think, if the 94 election should be a mandate for anything, it should be a mandate for an end to the term limits movement, because it goes to show that you can have term limits anytime you want to when there's an election. I mean, we just had term limits in action.
Mario Cuomo.
Yeah.
Tom Foley.
Yeah.
Dan Rostenkowski. If
That's
there's
right.
ever somebody who needed to bite the dust.
John Kasich?
Yeah.
No.
Oh, God, that was one of my favorite dreams, Jim.
But no, it goes to show that the best term limits happen at the ballot box.
Hey, some parting thoughts here on Columbus. What was it like to spend 5.5 years of your life in Columbus, Ohio?
It's a great town. It truly is a great town, and I'm going to remember a lot of people.
Are you just
here.
Saying that because you're
no.
trying to come back and
no.
get a job here?
I may come back sometime. It's a great town. I've done a lot of growing and changing here, and there is a lot of this town that will be forever a part of me, and that's no jive. I think we're about out of time. Right?
Well, we're just about out of time. Okay. Well, I saw our production person giving us those signals. I think those were the 5-minute signals, so if you got any other last things.
Looked like she was having a heart attack to me.
Oh, okay. Well, that could be the 5-minute warning. Let me go over here to this camera. Hi, Bob Petraeus. Here one last time, maybe not one last time, because I'm sure these liberals, when they slither in town, what I found out is that liberals these days slither. When Jim slithers back in town, he'll probably come to this studio and appear on this show. And I'm sure he'll be checking in from time to time, letting us know what he's doing around the country, whether it's in Hartford or someplace else. And again, I met Jim, last story here. I was sleeping out with the homeless. A homeless, of course, criticized me because I put him in a wind tunnel. And while we were there sleeping out and it was freezing, there was only one journalist in Columbus who really came down and sought us out, which is probably why he ended up not doing journalism anymore. But that was Jim Blykamp, who came down and wanted, here's the big problem here, wanted the homeless advocates and the homeless people on his show. And it's that sort of, I think really, Jim, it was the best newsman in Columbus, particularly the news he used to do at CD 101, not just because occasionally it allowed me to do analysis, but he really was all over town and he broke a lot of stories. And sure, he's not Cindy Lazarus's bosom buddy, but he was a hell of a newsman.
I am speechless.
Okay, Jim Blykamp.
I wouldn't dare follow that.
Speechless. And that's it then. Check in.
Thank you, Bob.
And of course, your tie.
Yes.
And this is it. One last time. Big Jim Blykamp, some girl's time. This is it. The end of an era. I'm alone. I'm isolated. What happens next?
There's a whole waiting list of people wanting to get on this show.
Yeah, name one.
Greg Lashetka, Chalmers Wiley.
Chalmers P. Wiley, John Kasich.
Yeah, I didn't say what they were going to say or not say when they get here. They want to confront you, Bob, is what it boils down to.
Well, Jim, they're always welcome on from the Democratic left, as you are. Thanks. It's the end of the year show. Goodbye. Stop. Spin us out.
's, we've known about some of them for quite a while from experimental animal studies. We've known for a long time that you could, in fact, kill the fetus without causing any overt effects on the mother in a number of animal species. What we've found in the last couple years, a number of laboratories have reported that at very low levels of exposure, levels that might be 1,000-fold lower than, for example, lethal kind of doses, maybe even lower than that, cause permanent changes on the reproductive development of both the male and female offspring. These changes are not evident at birth, but in fact are only evident when the offspring reach puberty, when their sexual development doesn't appear to respond appropriately to the surge of testosterone in the male or estrogen in the female. We don't know yet how applicable this is to the human population, but we are seeing these kinds of effects in multiple species of experimental animals. Dioxin also, I may come back to this later, dioxin is unequivocally an animal carcinogen. It's been tested at least 18 times in mice, rabbits, hamsters, and fish. It's been tested in males and females, and in all cases, dioxin does cause cancer in multiple tissues and is not causing cancer in a single site. We have multiple tissues that are affected. The recent epidemiology data has shown an association between high levels of exposure to dioxin and elevated and an increased incidence of cancer in the human population. The human data is extremely compatible with the animal data as well. Dioxin has been shown to be a powerful immunosuppressant in a number of animal species. We have very little data at this point to say whether this is happening in people or not. There's some suggestive data indicating that some of the that these children who were born to women who had been poisoned in the Far East, and children who are born to the Inuits in northern Quebec, whose mothers have very high levels of these compounds in their breast milk and in their blood, these children appear to have a much higher incidence of respiratory infections and a much higher incidence of otitis. But this is suggestive incidence. It's not conclusive at all at this point. Dioxin also has multiple effects on biochemical parameters in our body. Dioxin changes our basic metabolic capability and the way that we handle our hormones and other drugs. This can alter our basic metabolism. Dioxin affects almost every hormonal system in our body. Our hormones control our homeostasis, and basically dioxin, depending upon the sex, the species, the developmental stage, and the tissue you look at, may increase or decrease hormones. It may increase or decrease the hormone receptors. The bottom line is it can alter their levels. Dioxin also alters or modulates the levels of growth factors, which are factors, for example, that control, again, how cells divide and differentiate, and this is going to alter how an organism develops.
Commentator's Kay Jones, has he left as well? I thought so. Next commentator is Michael Pampili. Is he left? No, he's right here.
Thanks for the opportunity. My name's Mike Pampili, Assistant Health Commissioner, Columbus Health Department. Just have a very brief statement because I've already given the record into the record there, my written report. Basically, after hearing the comments and everything else, you've reaffirmed what we've pretty much found with the dioxin sources, the great uncertainty that exists there. We strongly encourage to try to tighten that thing up to find out where things are coming from. And that's just from a strict science standpoint. The overall goal is to reduce the dioxin levels within our community. What we hope you to end up doing by identifying the sources, you can do that in the most effective and efficient way for our communities and stuff like that. Second thing I wanted to just toy on was the human health uncertainty issues. We have went through the proceedings of the International Dioxin Conferences from 90, 91, 92, and 93, and 94. On top of that, we've went through many numerous peer-reviewed journals across the country, scientific journals. We are still looking for that health effects study at background, current background levels. And if you can find them, would you please somehow get them to us? We have researched and researched and researched, and we just can't find them at the current background levels.
Let me interrupt him for a second. I'm not sure what you're asking. Are you asking for a study looking at health effects in the current background population, or are you asking for a study, additional information on what current background levels are in the population?
No, we found what current background levels are, but what we're hunting for is, in effect, we have found, like you pointed out very vividly, that the health effects with lab animals and stuff like that. We've seen some of the things with the occupational studies, Finger Hut, Mann's, and a few other ones. But when you get down to what we're experiencing as the current background levels in this country, we cannot find a peer-reviewed health study.
The only peer-reviewed health study that I know of, I mean, it's very difficult. How do you, what's your control population? You don't have a control population. We're all exposed. And therefore, the only way we can begin to approach this issue is by if we look at a large enough population sample with enough measurements so that we have a range within the general population, maybe we can do something. There is some data coming out of the Dutch. Some of this is published in peer-reviewed journals, other of it is in press, indicating some subtle health effects in newborns whose mothers have higher levels of dioxin and furans as compared to mothers who have lower levels. This is general population exposure.
Well, I'm familiar with the ones, Corin study on background levels, where in effect he didn't find anything in the international dioxin proceedings. Basically, I would like to see those studies if you have, and we'd like to take a look through them. And take a look at those. I mean, we don't have the resources either to go find all these things. We're trying, and every time we go out, we ask for them. Basically, that's it. That's the only thing we ended up saying, except one other point, is that as a public health official, we have to bring up certain questions from time to time, and sometimes it puts us in criticism. But at the same time, the public health agency, as put out by the Future of Public Health, the Institute of Medicine, The public health agency's special role in policy development means it must pay attention to the quality of the process of death itself, in addition to that of a particular decision. It must raise crucial questions that no one else raises. And basically what we're trying to do is get at the answers. We appreciate the time and that you took to do this. Just looking for some answers. Thank you.
Hi, this is Bob on your left side. Well, we looked at a little dioxin reassessment. We said goodbye to Jim Blykamp. But we're all looking for some answers here. You saw Mike Pompili, and I've been very critical of the assistant health commissioner. I think he's doing more than looking for answers. I think Mr. Pompili has emerged as one of the leading apologists for this unfunded mandates movement and his political ambition, tying himself to Greg Luschetka and Governor Voinovich, who you can see on C-SPAN, hyping, particularly the governor recently, hyping this unfunded mandates movement, this attack on the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. I hope that you picked up that we do have some problems with dioxin here, that it is one of the most potent and dangerous chemicals imaginable. It's beyond me why a public health commissioner who doesn't work for the Solid Waste Authority would be spending the bulk of his time trying to claim that there's no real evidence that dioxin is a health problem. Dioxin is a killer. It's a dangerous, poisonous toxin. And the Luschetka and Pompelis have not played fair with the public health. Recently, you may have seen that the cancer rates on the south side of Columbus are abnormally high. Let me suggest this. Note in the tape, they said the dioxin is an immunosuppressant. What happens is not the traditional cancers that are caused a little later after prolonged exposure to dioxin will take place, but if your immune system is suppressed, more traditional cancers can grow and foster and manifest themselves because you've suppressed the immune system, which will fight off that cancer and those tumors. So, not only have we had this problem in our town with this question of dioxin, also recently, our mayor has been trying to tell us why we have to shut down Sullivan Gardens because it's on a floodplain, but at the same time, even closer to the floodplain, Battelle, where many major donors to the mayor exist, can build a radioactive and toxic dump right there on the river. So on the one hand, Sullivan Gardens has to shut down because it's on a floodplain. On the other hand, Battelle can build a radioactive and toxic waste dump. How can the mayor have it both ways? Make sure, with Bob on your left side, that you keep informed and that we fight back and fight these people who want to destroy the citizens and the people's environmental movement in our great country.
This is a shut it down victory celebration because we just shut down one of the largest known sources of dioxin in the United States. That is the Columbus trash burning power plant. And this is part of the celebration here. We're eating wings in the name of the people.
Excellent article. Excellent article.
How do you feel about this victory celebration?
I think it's about 11 years too late, but other than that, we'll see. It's a relief.
How about Bonnie Raitt?
Yay!
Paul Connett.
Paul Connett.
Ellen Connett.
Ellen.
Peter Montague.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, we've got to admit that Sandra doesn't know the science Greg Luschetka does. Greg Luschetka, the world's greatest scientist.
Whistleblower for the plant, unnamed.
Yay.
About a group of
good people that can make anything happen if they stick together.
Yeah.
That's a nice toast.
I like that.
Coming from a politician, no less.
In Spanish, the people united will never be defeated.
Down. Reds could move to five games, and well, the San Francisco Giants not going to be eliminated today. We're happy to hear that. Quinones homered his last time up, number two on the year. Looks at a pitch downstairs. Luis had a bunch of singles in the second inning, scored a run, struck out, hit into a fielder's choice, and then hit the stroke to his second home run of the season, the seventh. Pitch misses away.
Philadelphia and Montreal are now in the 15th inning.
I should say that for the last day of the year. And that's the guy you really
out of
play.
You're out of
it. They're trying to, I guess they're working on their ERA type.
They're doing a good job of it. Jackson, what a day he had. Seven innings, six hits, six strikeouts. He walked two and two earned runs. It's good to get him ready.
Nice to get everybody ready. And wouldn't it be great if they were clinched on Thursday? The sooner the better, but everybody has to be patient right now. There's a pitch on the outside edge for 16 hits for the Reds. Eric Davis with four. They're blocked nicely by Mark Perrin, but Eric Davis not going
for O'Neill. Billy 0 for 4. Now got two hits. Quinones 2. Reed 1. Turn Winningham with 1. And Terry Lee. There's Terry's ranging once again. He shows good range out at second base. Well, a hit. A runner stranded. 9-2. We go to the bottom of the ninth.
We save $1,500 on a new Camry.
Save on Camry, the most trouble-free compact in America.
I save $2,000 on my Corolla.
Save on Corolla, the most trouble-free subcompact in America. It's Toyota's year-end clearance on Toyota trucks, Camrys, Corollas, every Toyota car and truck.
I save $1,400 on my Toyota truck.
Stop waiting. Toyota's year-end clearance is here. Hurry in now.
Featuring the collections of Hugo Boss, Giorgio Armani, and Andrew Fencer, the shops that really care what you wear. Dino's, and a gift from Helbros, the new tradition in time. See Helbros quartz watches at leading stores and catalog showrooms.
There are many reasons you won't want to miss Ben Appreciation Day on Sunday, and that is Appreciation Day, September 30th, when the Reds take on the Padres at 2:15. The Reds and their many fine sponsors are offering great prizes, as you see them going across the screen to
you're supposed to read them as they
all
go.
All fans, you read them and I'll read this. And all fans have a chance to win. It's all the excitement of Reds baseball and the chance to great prizes. And don't miss the fun. That's Fan Appreciation Day. September 30th, 2:15 p.m. Postcard entry accepted. And it is Fan Appreciation Day.
Sunday, September the 30th at 2:15.
And I appreciate all the help that you've given me.
Given you a lot of hell at times. We've had a lot of fun with it. You're absolutely one of the neatest people on earth, and I appreciate the year.
And thank you to Jesse and Roy and everybody who has helped me.
You know, Jesse said a lot of things about you, and I did defend you. Is almost over.
He's trying to figure out what his problem is. Maybe that is it.
happening so early. I started listening to you and started saying Paliarulo. But I want to tell you, why are they calling Pags, as we talked about, I think, last time? They call him Pags, and his name, you have to pronounce his name Paliarulo. Look at that. Good pitch by Rayana. He's back. Danny Jackson, winning pitcher, 6-6. The Reds put on a show here in San Diego as they score 34 runs in four games, and Lou Piniella and his gang. What a wonderful day.
The only thing that's more fun than staying home to watch the game is going out to watch the game. So come on down, catch the game with Budweiser, Bud Light, and Bud Drop, and enjoy all the action on and off the field.
From San Diego, Jack Murphy Stadium, and the first time ever, Tommy, that the Cincinnati Reds have swept a four-game series in Jack Murphy Stadium.
Well, you know, you look at that, plus also you look at the troubles they've had on the West Coast, just the West Coast, they've had their problems, but you come out here, sweep a four-game series, and then you take taking these guys and be able to drop that magic number down, I mean, it's great.
Well, we know it's six, and it could be...